Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us for worship once more here on Facebook this morning. It's a wonderful time for us to get together to worship. I know it's a little bit gloomy outside, it's raining outside, but it's always filled with joy no matter what situation, no matter what the weather may be. We're always grateful to be able to gather together to worship our Lord Jesus Christ. And so, just to let a couple of us know, well, this is the Advent season. This is our third Sunday of the Advent season. So, I remind us to continue to prepare our hearts, continue to prepare the way for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ as we come to our Christmas celebration. And so, continue to focus on our Lord Jesus Christ. And not only that, I also want to give thanks to all those who were able to make it to our Zoom Church annual conference meeting yesterday with our district superintendent, the Reverend Dr. Blake Busick. And I think we had a very successful and productive meeting yesterday. And so thank you so much for those of you who were able to make it. One of the things that I just want to announce to let us know is that our current membership in our church is at 170. Okay, that's 170 members. Our Hmong for our Hmong congregation, we had a growth of 10 people, mainly through new birth, new babies. And so we have 110 Hmongs in our Hmong congregation. And then in our English service, we lost two people this past year. We lost Rudy and we also lost Junior this past year. So in our English service or our English congregation, we have 60 members. And so we are at 170 members as compared to last year, we had 161. And so just to let everybody know about that, just to keep everybody updated on that, we still need to work more on updating our membership role within our church too. And so Bill Cheek is our membership secretary, and so we'll be working on that to make sure everything is updated for us. Just to let us know, our church is closed until further notice because of the situation here in California with all of our with most of the counties are in the purple tier. And so what that means is basically that we cannot worship indoors. We are allowed to worship outdoors, but of course the weather does not permit us to do that at this time. And so we'll keep the church closed until further notice. And basically, when there's any changes within the county, we will make changes also. Okay, so let all of us know that our preschool is also currently closed at this time, although they are planning to resume in January, but we will talk more about that once January comes around. Then our Christmas Eve service this year, I would like to have it at 6 p.m. Okay, at 6 p.m. If that does not work for you, please let me know. We do have it every year at 7 p.m. But I like since this year we're gonna have it online, I would like to have it at 6 p.m. Okay, and so I've been asking for us to do for our church families to send over videos. I've received a few videos, probably about maybe about 4 or 5 videos from some of our families, but they've all been from our Hmong families, okay? And so I need some videos from our those who are part of our English congregation also. And so please do send those videos over. I will start working on them as soon as possible, maybe tonight and tomorrow morning, and get them ready for a Christmas Eve service. So for that Christmas Eve service, I want to be able to play those videos for all of us. And you know, we've been apart for since you know, since the end of March, and so I'm pretty sure we all want to see each other. And so I think at this time, as we come together for our Christmas Eve service, a good time for us to see each other, just see a video of how each family is doing. So I do encourage you to send that over. Just you know, if you're unable to do it, let me know. I mean, let me know if you need some help. Let me know, and I'll see what I can do to help you. But typically, you can just use your if you have a smartphone. You can just use your smartphone to record a short video and just send that over to me, okay, to my email. So just want to encourage everybody to do that. Not only that, I've been reaching out to our parents who have had new babies here the past year and a half or so, to send pictures over to me. And so I've received a few pictures also, but I haven't received everybody's pictures. So I just want to encourage us to continue to do that. Send those pictures over to me. I want to put those pictures up for our Christmas Eve service and read the names of all the children, all the new babies of our church, and just let everybody know who they are. I know typically in the Hmong custom, typically what we do is when we have a new child is we have a blessing party for them. But of course, this year we're unable to do that because of the pandemic. So I just want to be able to give them some recognition and also share with our church who these new babies are. So please do send those pictures over. Okay? So chat the puro pepo hay te pe no sé no sé nada no sé otro pe ya gente ya van a poner hasta con pe to pe to que pe pe to que charla no me pe que charla si son de pe to DS que no me pin to charla yendo sol zoom es como ando ya chat de hecho si no me como y hijo tengo chat de pe no no voy a pe membership ni to hope pe ponjen tiene to hope pe ponjen la de pe to tan todo que no de pe mo y pues ya te online okay te to mong la de pe mo y pues go online okay มองเป็นมองอีปกกับเล่นจะมีการจะเป็นมองโจโจเล่นนะฮะเรื่องนั้นโจเป็นสุดแล้วป๊อปจะมีการนะจะเราดูจะรู้ช่องก็จะเป็นตัวเสียออตุลาโอ้ยรูดี้เรียรูดี้จะมีกุยคริสตัลสีเทียโอเคจะเป็นคนนั้นเราเป็นป๊อปที่จะตั้งนั้นจะเป็นเสียรูดี้จะเป็นเสียจูเนียร์จะรูดี้นั่นจะเป็นเสียตัวลูกอ่อนหินดูอันจูเนียร์นั่นจะเป็นเสียตัวลูกหญิงหินดูฮะเรื่องนั้นปูจะเป็นสุดแล้วป๊อปจะตั้งนั้นจะเป็นเป็นยกเกิลชาร์จตัวลูกศิษย์ตั้งนั้นจะเป็นยามุดูโควิดก่อนจวนนั้นนั่นจะเป็นจังเกิลชาร์จนั้นเนี่ยเราไปรู้ย้อนเนี่ยเราไปรู้แข่งทีมาแล้วยิ่งปุ๊บก็ไปต่อไปเหรอวันจริงเนี่ยตรงโดนร้องเลยจุ๊บไปเหรอวันจริงเนี่ยต้องเข้าใจนะแต่เช้าปุ๊บไปเหรอวันจริงเนี่ยตรงโดนร้องแต่สิบยาแต่รู้แจ้งแต่เช้าเนี่ยรู้แจ้งตัวหน้าเตะรู้แจ้งตัวนอนแล้วนะเจ๊ไปต่อจุดต่อตรงโดนร้องเลยเที่ยงนะเจ๊ไปเรามาเชิดเกล้าเนี่ยถอดตัวไปแต่ก็เคี่ยวเลยสิแข่งทีปุ๊บไปเคี่ยวแล้วนะเจ๊ก็มาเลยแต่ก็ชัดแต่ปุ๊บไปจริงจริงไปเท่าไหร่ต่อแต่ก็ตัวไปเหรอวันจริงก็เกี่ยวจิตันเลยสิมองว่าคริสต์มาสอีฟยามมองนั่งก็บล็อกนะลูกก็เล่นด้วยมาที่นั่งก็บล็อกนะเจ๊ถอดโจมจงดูนะเจ๊ไปยังมาไปเหรอวันจริงเนี่ยตัวโซนเฟซบุ๊กนั่นนะเที่ยงเดี๋ยวจะขอไปเหรอวันจริงเนี่ยกูสักเนี่ยสายดับวิดีโอตัวนี้อีเจติ้งสายดับวิดีโอตัวละกูเนี่ยไทยดับวิดีโอเนี่ยสาตัวละกูเนี่ยหูยังก็ต้องหัวเราะยิ่งโตเนี่ยหายใจลุ้นเชิดเสด็จตัวจอนเนี่ยต้องหัวเราะยิ่งโตเนี่ยสาตัวละกูกูมันจอดตัวโซนนะจอดตัวโซนอินเทอร์เน็ตตัวโซนได้ใช่หายในตัวไปเดี๋ยวจะตั้งตัวสุดไปจอนเนี่ยจะโอนเนี่ยโอซีโอเนี่ยห้องมันจะมีตู้มีอยู่เนี่ยจะเนี่ยจะตู้จนเช้าเนี่ยขออยู่ตัวเชียนอะไรอย่างเนี่ยห้องสาวเลยจะโดนตัวไปเที่ยวไปสามวันจะโดนนะจะละมุนจอดตัวโซนนะจอดตัวของเฟซบุ๊กนะตัวไปปั้นเจนตัวไปจังเจนสุดแล้วตัวปอดเนี่ยโอเคในหายในตัวไปสุดแล้วปอดลูชันต่อจริงว่าจะเจอในหนังสือในท้องมันจะหาฟองก้อนฟองมองปูดตัวไปส่วนในสุดตู้ลูชันต่อฉันเป็นยังไงตัวสักเก็บไปเหรอวันจีแต่ this time we will be entering into our worship service and soWe'll be opening up with a Hmong hymn, Kutito. So, okay, it's on you.
Kutito.Thank you.
Praise the Lord. We know that no matter what we are going through, that the blood of Jesus Christ will always be able to wash away all the troubles and all the sins and all the things that we're going through. And so we have hope because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And so that's what the song is talking about. And may the Lord be with all of us. And so let's pray together. Vanchi to pelengti jong shio ka chao. Vanchi pe jong shio ka ngauli nuna pe tato nyao ke to pe ha ka doha. Vanchi ta ya sha ho sha tio la vanchi ka tun chu tu pe yin yang na tai pe. Pe ta ho ka pe ta jong shio. To cho ya chao ka ta pu to pe te kong te mong ka chi. O ka ta fong pu to pe jang jing sha da. Vanchi ta ya pe mo te ya ke nyo shin sa pla sa li tu ko ve ko tio na la vanchi ka yin chi ti tai pe pen jing tu chu pu pe to. Te ke ka mo keng keng na te vanchi. Vanchi pe And God, we thank you so much for this day as we gather together to worship you. We thank you so much for your spirit to be among us, to continue to just bless us as we do our ministry here within our community. We ask that you continue to empower us with your Holy Spirit so that we may be the light into this community, into the city of Oroville here, so that they may be able to see your love, that they may be able to experience your grace upon their lives. And so as we gather this morning to worship you, may you be with us and may you bless us and may we lift up our hearts to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now this next hymn here, or this next praise song here that we'll be doing, is called Let It Rain by Michael W. Smith. It is a song that is, it is repetitive. I mean, it is just, there's just a few words to the song, but it is repetitive, but it is a song about inviting the Holy Spirit into our lives, inviting God into our lives. And so as we sing, or as we listen to this song, I want us to just reflect on that, just want us to focus on that, on inviting the Holy Spirit into our lives. And as we, because the message that we'll be talking about today is to do not quench the Spirit, from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 19 to verse 22. And so today it's about not quenching the Holy Spirit, but, you know, it's about just inviting the Spirit into our life, inviting the Holy Spirit into our hearts and our minds, and allowing him to minister to us. So let it rain.
Let rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it. Sing out. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain.
Let it rain.
Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven.
Come on.
The Lord reigns.
Let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice. Clouds and thick darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and consumes his foes on every side. His lightning lights up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord. Before the Lord of all the earth, the heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all peoples will see his.
Grace of the Lord reign upon us on this day, and may the power of the Holy Spirit be upon us, empower us through the season as we await our Lord Jesus Christ. And at this time, it's time for us to enter into our joys and prayers. So I'd like to continue to pray for Jim. Continue to pray for Jim. It is a great thing that he is now back home, and so but he still needs prayers for his healing. And so may the Lord be with Jim and also with Sue. Bless them at this time, especially during this Christmas season. The Lord comfort them at this time. Also pray for Shisha's parents. They called me this morning. They've been experiencing some illnesses, and so just pray for both of them, for both of Shisha's parents. Also pray for our brother Wayne Wires. He's a big part of our dinner at 6, and he recently passed away. And so do pray for him. And at this time, if you have any joys, any concerns that you would like to share with us, please, and put them into our comment section, and I will pray for us. Thank you. Let us pray together. Our mighty God, we stand before you, before your throne in all of your glory, in all of your majesty. How great you are, that you created the heavens and the earth with your words. You spoke everything into existence. You breathe life into each and every single one of us. In the palms of your hands, you continue to hold our lives. In your arms, you continue to provide comfort for those who are yours. Before the foundations of the world, before you created the heavens and the earth, you have already called us by our names and gathered us together to be your children, to be before your throne, to be before your glory, to worship you, to lift up our hearts to you, to know you, and to just praise you with our voices, with our lives, to give you so much glory. We thank you so much for all these things. On this day, as we come together to worship you, we ask that you rain upon us, that your grace continue to rain upon us, that you open up the floodgates of heaven, pour out your love to us. Even as today, even during this time of difficulty, as we're facing so many issues on this earth, we're facing so many issues in our nation, in our country, as we're facing this pandemic that has got us on a lockdown, we pray that you'll give us the patience to be able to go through this. We pray that you give us a heart to be able to think not only of ourselves during this pandemic, but also to give consideration to the safety and to the health of one another, because we are indeed in this battle here together. Let us be able to submit to those who are over us. Let us be able to submit to our leaders who watch over us. Let us be able to listen to one another during these difficult times. More importantly, God, we ask that you pour your spirit upon us. Empower us during this time, that through the storms of our lives, that we may see your Son, Jesus Christ, and see the opportunities to proclaim his name, to proclaim the gospel that you've entrusted to us during this time. In every storm, in every obstacle, in every difficult times, there's always an opportunity. There's always a door that opens up for us. Give us the wisdom, bless us with the wisdom to be able to see that door that you have provided for us. Give us the wisdom to be able to see the goodness of who you are through all the things that we face in our lives. Not only with the pandemic, but even in the things, the personal things in our lives that we continue to face on a daily basis. Let us see the goodness in all the troubles that we may face. And at this time, we would like to lift up our brother Jim to you. Oh, how wonderful it is to know and to hear that he is now home. What a tremendous, tremendous blessing it is. We continue to see the works of your power among our church, among our congregation. We continue to see your miracles. We continue to see your healing power upon us. May we always remember these moments. May we always cherish and keep these moments in our hearts to keep our faith strong in you, knowing that you are a loving God and that you have loved us and that you have healed us, that you have blessed us as a church. From the time in which we were born up until this moment, as we reflect upon our lives, we continue to see your blessings upon us and how wonderful it is. We continue to see the testimony of your love in our lives and how wonderful it is. Great miracles, healing power upon our lives. We also lift up Jesus' parents to you during this time. Watch over them. Watch over them, be with them, and provide them the healing power that you've already provided many, many in our church. Provide them with the healing power that your Son, Jesus Christ, provided for many when he walked on this earth. May they be healed. May they be blessed. We lift up our brother Wayne to you. We lift him up to you. We know that at this moment he is no longer suffering. We know that at this moment that he is in paradise with you. How grateful we are for that. We pray that you give his family comfort. You give them faith. You give them strength at this time. He is a brother to us, brother in which supports the ministry of our church through our dinner at 6. And we're so grateful for all the things that he's done. We're so grateful that you've blessed us, blessed our church, with the opportunity to know him, to have him as one of our brothers. So we lift him up to you. We also remember our brother Rudy on this day. We also remember our brother Jimmy on this day. That this past year they passed away. They have gone on to glory. We know that as Christians in Jesus Christ, there are no goodbyes, because we know one day we'll see them once again. We can't wait on that day in which we greet them at the gates of heaven before the angels above. Well, how wonderful that will be for us to see them once more in paradise in your kingdom in heaven before your throne. And we'll wait for that day. But as we await for that day, our hearts are heavy. So we ask that you be with us too. We ask that you bless us. Allow us to continue to remember them in our lives. Allow us to continue to remember the things that we, to cherish the moments that we spent with the both of them. We love them dearly and we love their families dearly. We lift all of them up to you. And so at this time, as we go into the ministry of your word, at this time, as we go into the preaching of your word, we ask for your wisdom to guide us. We ask for your spirit to teach us. For us not to quench the spirit of God, but for us to fan these gifts that the Spirit has given to us, these blessings that the Spirit has given to us, to fan these things into a flame, into a fire, a consuming fire that will bless our lives and the lives of those around us. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not quench the Spirit. This message is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19 through verse 22. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19 through verse 22. In this Bible verse, the Apostle Paul wrote to the early Christians, he said to them, do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good and reject every kind of evil. You know, Hmong families are usually very, very big families. We see that all the time in our churches. Whenever they have a party, a blessing party for their children, whenever they have a wedding or whatever it is that they're doing, and they gather together, we always see hundreds of people coming together. We see many, many people coming together. And so Hmong families are usually very, very big families, of course, except for my family. My family is not that big. And we didn't have much. We didn't have many when we were growing up. But one thing I did have was that I did have my cousins and them who lived in San Jose. And so while other families would have visitors weekly to their houses or to their homes, all we really had was each other growing up. That's all we really had. And Christmas would be that time that my cousins and them, my aunt and my uncle, they would usually visit from San Jose. And that's usually the only time of the year that my family, that my brothers, sisters, and I, along with my parents, that we ever truly get visitors into our home, into our house. Other than that, we didn't really have much visitors. But as a kid, we would get so excited every single year when we heard the news that our cousins were coming to visit us. We would be so excited about it, and many times we would stay up all night long just to have the chance to see them arrive at our front door. And many times we would fall asleep before they arrive. But those times that we were able to stay up and greet them at the door, we would just rush outside into our front yard, and we would just welcome them, and we would just greet them when they arrived. And those were the exciting days, exciting times of my own childhood. Just waiting for my cousins, just waiting for my aunt and my uncle to visit us, because we didn't have many visitors in our house. But now today, as Christians, during the season of Advent, it is a time in which we are waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, to celebrate not only his birth, but also to remind us of his second coming, as we await for that. Now, one of the things I want to ask you is this: how excited are you? See, when I was waiting for my cousins during that time, I was so excited to be able to finally see them after a whole year. Now, as a Christian during this season, how excited are you as you wait for your Lord Jesus Christ? How anxious are you as you prepare yourself to greet him on that day in which he returns to this earth during the second coming? How anxious are you to meet with him, to greet him? You see, because when Paul wrote these words here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19 through verse 22, when Paul wrote these words to the early first century Christians, this was exactly what he was thinking about. Paul was thinking about the second coming of Jesus Christ, and he was sharing early first century Christians as to how they can prepare themselves to wait for the Lord, and how they can prepare themselves for this day of the Lord, how they can prepare themselves for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. They live their life knowing and being convicted that yes, Jesus Christ is going to come, that Jesus Christ is going to be there, that there is going to be a day in which Christ will return. And so they live their life with a sense of urgency, wanting to proclaim the gospel to everybody that they could proclaim the gospel to, because they wanted everyone to hear the good news of Jesus Christ, just so that they can also be prepared on that day in which Jesus Christ would return. How excited are we? How convinced are we as Christians nowadays that Jesus Christ will return once again? And we see this conviction in the writings of the Apostle Paul when he wrote in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 through verse 2, he says, "Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." And so, in other words, the Apostle Paul is saying that we don't know when the Lord is coming. But what we do know is that he is coming. What we do know is that he is coming, and that we must live our lives in preparation of that. That we must live our lives every single minute of every single day, knowing that Jesus Christ will come any minute. That he can come any time, any minute, any second. And we don't know when that will be, but we know and we are convinced that he is coming. And then in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 6, Apostle Paul goes on and he says, "Let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober." And so he's going back to that theme again about the second coming of Jesus Christ. So he's saying that, don't let us be caught off guard when Jesus Christ returns. Don't let us be asleep. Don't let us be unprepared on that day in which Christ returns. But let us be ready for it. Because we never know when Christ is going to return. So there is a theme here. There is a theme in these verses. There is a theme here in the book of 1 Thessalonians to practically teach us how to prepare ourselves for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is what we do during our Advent season, is to prepare ourselves for this time. And these practical advice are things such as that we must be awake. In other words, we must always be looking forward to that day in which Christ is coming. We must always be prepared for that day in which Christ is coming. We must always live our lives, every moment of every day, being ready for that day that Christ will return. And we must live our life like many times we don't have that sense of urgency in our churches. Many times we don't have that sense of urgency in the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to evangelize, to bring people to Jesus Christ anymore, because many times we have forgotten that Christ will return to judge the world. But it is in that, knowing that Jesus Christ will return to judge the world soon, that he will return one day. It is in knowing that and being convinced in that, that will give us that sense of urgency, that I must proclaim the gospel now. I must not wait any longer. That I must do the ministry of the Lord now, today, at this moment, right now. And I must not wait any longer, because I never know when Christ is going to return. I must prepare myself. And not only must I prepare myself, I must prepare my family. I must prepare my children. I must prepare my brothers and my sisters, my siblings, my parents, my friends, my church, my country, my world. I must prepare everybody. We must be in this together as we prepare ourselves for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as I said last week, we are in a time in which Christmas, the Christmas season, has become so commercialized, it has become so secularized, that many times we talk about Christmas trees, we talk about, you know, Santa Claus, we talk about reindeers, we talk about all these things, we talk about shopping. We just did some of our Christmas shopping yesterday. We talk about all these things that keep us so busy, but sometimes we forget about Jesus Christ. And this is the time for us as Christians to proclaim that Jesus is the reason, right? There's that saying, Jesus is the reason for the season. No one else is going to do that. But it is our responsibility as the church, as Christians, to continue to remind the world that the reason we're celebrating this Christmas, the reason why we're putting up these decorations, the reason why we're buying these gifts, it is all because of the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. As we prepare those Christmas trees, as we put those decorations and those lights around our Christmas trees, as we put those lights around our houses, let those times, let those moments remind us that we must prepare our hearts just as much as we prepare those Christmas trees for the Christmas season, for that day in which we will come together, on that Christmas morning when we will come together to open those Christmas presents. Let those Christmas presents, let those gifts remind us of the greatest gift of all, which is our Lord Jesus Christ. Let all those decorations that prepares us for that very day that we open that gift, let all those decorations, all that work that we put into the decorations that we do, let all the time that we put into buying gifts, into shopping, let all of that remind ourselves that we need to prepare our hearts. We need to prepare our lives the very same way as we prepare those things. Paul goes on, he says, we need to be awake. We need to encourage one another. See in verse 11, he talks about one of the practical ways for us to do this in preparing ourselves for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ is to encourage one another and to build each other up. To acknowledge our leaders in the church, to acknowledge our pastors, to hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. To live in peace with each other to just live in peace. Verse 13 talks about that. To warn those who are disruptive. To warn those who are being idle. To warn those who are no longer convinced in the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Even in our churches today, there are so many people who are no longer convinced that Jesus Christ is going to return. They say, you know, it's been 2,000 years. If Christ have not returned by now, Christ is not going to return. And so they forget about that. They forget about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But as Christians, when we celebrate the Advent season, we're always reminded that yes, just as Christ came into this world 2,000 years ago, one day he will return once more. He will return once more, and we are to prepare ourselves for that day. We are to prepare one another for that day. We are to encourage those who have been disheartened in the faith. We need to help those who are weak in the faith, encourage them, build them up. We're to be patient with everyone. Many times we get so excited about this. Many times we want to focus on this so much. We want everyone to remember about this, that we lose our patience with those within our churches. When someone starts to become, you know, idle, we start losing our patience with them. But the Word of God is telling us, don't be impatient with them, but rather be patient and encourage them. Encourage them once more. Bringing them once more back to the message of Jesus Christ. Back to the message of the gospel. So that they will understand that Christ is coming again. So that they too will be ready. They too will be prepared on that day in which the Lord Jesus Christ returns. Paul goes on in this chapter talking to us about don't pay back wrong for wrong. Don't pay evil for evil. Don't be vengeful in the things that you do. Then he goes on and talks about always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone. And then, of course, we read the Bible verse says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances. We talked about this Bible verse a few weeks ago. And this is how we are to live. This is how we are to live as we prepare ourselves for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it all leads us here to these verses here towards the end of this book, towards the end of this letter in which the Apostle Paul writes to these early first century Christians. And he goes on and he says, do not quench the Spirit. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. And so there's a couple points here, and just these couple of these Bible verses here. And he's saying the first thing is do not quench the Spirit. The second thing is do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. And the third thing is hold on to what is good and reject every kind of evil. Now, what does it mean to quench? Well, to quench, the word quench means to extinguish, to put out, or to suppress. Oftentimes, when we read the Word of God, we see that the Holy Spirit is oftentimes referred to as a fire. But when Paul is talking about quenching the Spirit here, Paul is not talking about extinguishing the person of the Holy Spirit. I want us to understand that, because there is no way for us to extinguish the person of the Holy Spirit. But what Paul is talking about here is he is talking about extinguishing the ministry or the works, or the grace, the effects of what the Holy Spirit is doing among us. And many times, so many times, we can do that as Christians. We can extinguish the ministry. We can extinguish this work of the Holy Spirit among us. I know many of us, we know people. We know people who, you know, there's just these people that sometimes when they walk into the room and they just kill the vibe of that entire room. You know, we know people like that. They're so negative in their lives. They're so negative in the things that they do. They just carry around this negative vibe in their lives that many times when they just enter into a room or they enter into a house, and many times they kill that vibe. They kill that positivity, that joy inside of that room. And there are people like that. We all know people like that. And this is what Paul is talking about, is that don't be like that. Don't kill the joy of the church. Don't extinguish these things that the Holy Spirit is doing among you. Because each and every single one of us, as Christians, the Word of God tells us and promises us that when you are a Christian, then the Holy Spirit lives in you. If we say we don't have the Holy Spirit, basically what we're saying is that we are not a Christian, because every single Christian has the Holy Spirit within them. They've been empowered by the Holy Spirit. But we do have this choice as to whether or not we're going to extinguish the ministry of the Spirit among us, or if we're going to fan it into a flame. And 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, the Apostle Paul wrote to young Timothy, and he says, "The fan into flame. Fan into flame the gift that God has given unto you." And that's what we need to do as Christians. Instead of extinguishing, or instead of quenching the Spirit, we need to fan into flame what the Spirit of God is doing among us, what the Holy Spirit is doing among us. Now, how is the Spirit quenched? How is the Spirit quenched? When the Spirit is quenched among us, when we don't believe in Jesus Christ, when we don't believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God anymore. Because the Holy Spirit comes from Jesus. Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 15 to verse 17, he says, "If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth." Jesus Christ here is talking about the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit comes, is given to us by the Father, given to us by Jesus Christ. And so if we reject Jesus Christ, we don't believe in Jesus Christ anymore, then we are quenching the ministry of the Holy Spirit within our very own churches. And there are so many churches today, because we want to pander to everything and everyone. There are so many churches today that don't even believe that faith in Jesus Christ is necessary anymore. That we don't need to believe in Jesus Christ to be a Christian anymore. There are so many seminaries here in America that don't even believe that faith in Jesus Christ is needed anymore. And so we bring so many people into our churches without ever telling them that they need to believe in Jesus Christ. And without Christ in our church, without faith in Christ in our church, we receive no blessings. There is no blessing upon us. And when there is no blessing, then we start to die out. When there is no blessing, then we start to decline as a church. But we need to realize one thing, that it all starts with faith in Jesus Christ. And this idea that we don't need faith in Jesus Christ usually comes from the idea, this humanistic view and this secular perspective, that church growth is something that we do. It is something that the pastor does. It is something that the church leader does. But that is not true at all. Paul says that I water, or I plant, Apollos water, but there is only one. There's only one that can make the church grow. See, Paul says this in 1 Corinthians. There is only one that can make the church grow. And he is the only one that matters. And that is God. God is the only one that makes the church grow. All we do is we plant and we water. But it is God who makes the church grow. And many times we forget that. We forget that it is up to God. And in order for us to grow, we need to put our faith in Jesus Christ. We need to believe in God. After Paul and Silas was put in prison, they were singing hymns, and they were praising God, and they were praying. And as they were doing this, a huge earthquake shook the entire prison. And so the jailer became so afraid. And so he came up to Paul and Silas, and he asked them in Acts chapter 16, verse 30, and he says to them, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And Paul and Silas replied to him in Acts chapter 16, verse 31. He says, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ." You see, we have to believe. Paul and Silas says, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." So we have to believe in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, as the Son of God, in order for us to be saved.
That's what the word says. That's what the word teaches us. And believing here does not mean, it does not mean that we simply believe in the existence of God. The scripture tells us that demons themselves believe in the existence of God. Yet they're scared, they're afraid, they shudder before God. So believer is not talking about simply believing that God exists. But the word believe here in Greek talks about putting one's faith or one's trust into something. And it implies, this belief here implies that that trust that you put in this something will result in action, will result in a change behavior. And that change behavior is repentance from sin. And so in order for us to not quench the Holy Spirit, is we must believe in who Jesus Christ is. He is the giver of life to us. He is the one that saves us. He is the Messiah, the Son of God. Without this faith in him, we cannot be empowered by the Holy Spirit in our lives. We quench the Holy Spirit when we deny who the Holy Spirit is by denying the Holy Trinity. Many Christians out there, many denominations out there denying the Holy Trinity. They believe that the Trinity, they believe that the Holy Spirit himself is just a power of God. It is just an effect of God. And that's not at all how the scripture describes or talks about the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit has spoken or has testified to us through the word is a person within the Trinity. So when we talk about the Holy Spirit, we're talking about a person within the Godhead of the Holy Trinity. And so we must allow the Spirit. We must allow the Spirit to do his ministry among us. We must not neglect our own spiritual gifts. We must allow the Holy Spirit to convict us of our own sins. And many times we don't want the Holy Spirit to convict us of our own sins. The very sin that is in our lives is keeping us away from knowing God. Because that's part of what the Holy Spirit does. That's the ministry of the Holy Spirit, is to convict the world of their sin. And many times we just want to get rid of this idea of sin in the church. And we just want to put our arms around each other and sing kumbaya, but we don't want to talk about sin anymore. But that's what the Holy Spirit does. When we ignore the conviction of sin, we are quenching the Holy Spirit in our lives. Because that's part of his ministry. When we get rid of biblical truth, when we neglect our own spiritual gifts, all these things are ministry of the Holy Spirit within our lives. And when we do these things, we're quenching the Holy Spirit. We're not allowing the Holy Spirit to minister to us anymore. And we must not do that. We must allow him to minister to us. We quench the Holy Spirit when we sin. Isaiah chapter 5 verse 20 says this. They say what is right is wrong, and what is wrong is right. That black is white and white is black. Bitter is sweet and sweet is bitter. When we ignore the teachings of the word, when we ignore the teachings of the Spirit in our lives, when we ignore his ministry, the conviction of sin in our own lives, we start thinking that sin is something that is good for us. And that's what Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, is talking about. We call good evil. We call evil good. We get everything upside down. We get everything wrong without the Holy Spirit. And that's why it's so important for us not to quench the Holy Spirit. It is so important for us to allow the Spirit to work in us. Because it is only through this, it is only through his ministry that we will know truth. We will know right from wrong. We will know what is bitter and what is sweet. We will know what is good and what is evil. We just leave it to us. There's no way for us to know. We'll continue to fight over these things for the rest of our lives without ever coming to any kind of resolution, without ever agreeing on anything. And it would do nothing for us, but it would just continue to cause division and hurt and wars among us. And it's only through God that will bring us peace. So we must not quench the Holy Spirit. We quench the Holy Spirit when we do not empower people. When we do not empower people into the ministry. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, the Apostle Paul wrote to young Timothy, and he says this: "What you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." The work of a Christian, the work of a pastor, the work of a church leader is to always help others identify their gifts, the gifts that God has given to them, and to empower them to use that spiritual gift for the ministry of the kingdom of God. And many times, what we do as leaders in the church, as Christians, as pastors, and many times what we do is that we try to take control of the ministry. We control the ministry. Yes, we want new members. We want to evangelize. We want to bring Christians, new Christians, into our church. But as we bring them into our church, we have no way of empowering them. We have no way of discipling them. And many times we don't even grant them the access to the opportunity to serve God. And we just keep them in the pews every single Sunday with no opportunity for them to exercise the gift that God has given to them. Many times inside the church, many of the leaders, once you get into a position for so long, you get into a position for so long that you don't want anyone to be a part of that ministry anymore. You don't want to open up that part of the ministry to the church anymore. You just want to control that part of the church. You know, being that I'm part of, that I've been part of the worship ministry for so long in my ministry, one of the things that I even see, I'll just use that as an example. You know, one of the things that I often see in churches is that many times worship pastors, worship directors in the church, they have control of that worship. They have control of the music. They have control of that aspect of the church. And they never want to relinquish that control to anybody else. They never want to involve anyone else into that ministry anymore. And so they take control of that. And yes, they want new members in the church, but they don't want to empower those new members to be able to serve in their ministry. And so they close the door. They close the opportunity for people to serve in the church. And that's when we do things like that, we are quenching the Holy Spirit. And so we must provide access to people. We must provide access to people to serve in the church. We must open up the opportunities for people to serve in the church. Our goal is to empower people to serve in the church. As I've always said, that the best pastors are the ones that work themselves out of a job. Because the best pastors are the ones who are always training new disciples. And they're able to raise up leaders within their churches. So many pastors, we are afraid. We're afraid of losing our job. So we don't want to teach people. We don't want to disciple people to take our positions, to be able to rise up and to become pastors in the church. Even in the United Methodist Church nowadays, we don't have enough clergy. We don't have enough pastors anymore. Because many times it's the pastors who close the doors for others who have that calling or who has that opportunity or who has that desire, that passion to serve as a pastor. But we close the door on them. We don't empower them because we're afraid that we might lose our job. And when we do things like that, whether it's in the ministry of being a clergy, whether it's in the ministry of the lay people, regardless, when we do things like that, we are quenching the Holy Spirit. And so we must empower people. We must empower people. grant them access into opportunities to serve. The second thing it talks about is do not treat prophecies with contempt. And prophecies are usually two types, forthtelling and foretelling. Forthtelling is based upon the word of God for the present situation. Foretelling is based upon the word of God for the future. But we must always remember this, that it's always based upon the revealed word of God. Today, we are so careless with these things. We're so careless with these things that we just proclaim anything to be a prophecy. And it is not true. You get a whim somewhere. You get some ideas somewhere. You get a feeling and you proclaim it to be a prophecy of God. That is not true. The prophecies of God must be based upon the revealed word of God. It is based upon the ministry of the word. That is so extremely important that the Bible even tells us that not everyone should be a teacher of the word, because you will be judged by God so much more strictly. James chapter 3 verse 1 says, not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. But yet this is so important in the ministry. It is so important. The ministry of the word is so significant and so essential to our lives, to our faith as Christians. Because faith comes from hearing the word of God. Many times we don't want to hear the word of God anymore in our church. We just want to hear some feel-good stories, man, some personal experiences and things like that. Man, I want to hear these people's personal experience about their faith. And these are good, but we must never stop in the proclamation and the proclamation of the word of God ever. Because the word of God in Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says that faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So we must never be in contempt with the ministry of the word. We must never lower the standard. We must never see this as something that is so insignificant in our lives. Many times we say, you know, I know I've been a Christian for so long. I know everything about the word of God already. The truth is, no one knows everything about the word of God. The truth is that we are going to spend all of eternity after this life here on earth. We are still going to spend all of eternity trying to understand this gospel, trying to understand this love and this grace of God. And yet it is so deep. It is so deep. It is so wide that even all of eternity will not truly be able to teach us how great the love of God is. That's how deep his wisdom is. And yet many times we say, you know, we already know everything, so we don't want to hear the ministry of the word anymore. We don't want to hear the preaching of the word anymore. But the truth is that it is only through the word that faith will come. The word of God teaches us that. And we must examine everything, all these prophecies, through the word. Discernment is so important for Christians. In Acts chapter 17, verse 11, it says the Berean Jews were more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. See, they tested what Paul was saying to them. They examined what Paul was saying to them to make sure that what Paul was saying was not some kind of falsehood, some kind of false message, but they wanted to make sure that what Paul was proclaiming was true. And we must not be lazy. We must not be lazy in our discernment. When we get lazy in our discernment, what we often do is we either ignore these prophecies, we either ignore the ministry of the word, or we become so gullible that we accept everything as truth. And that's just not the way it is. The word teaches us, the word of God teaches us that we must examine everything. We must examine everything through the scriptures to ensure that they are true. And any preacher, any pastor, any church leader who is worth anything will want you to do that. If there's ever a pastor, if there's ever someone who tells you that you are just to accept what they say without examining what they say through the scriptures, this should be a red flag for you. This is a false teacher. This is a false pastor. We must, even as pastors, this is what we want our people to do. This is what we want Christians to do, is we want them to examine what we say, to make sure that what we say is truth, as according to the scriptures. Because there are false teachers out there, brothers and sisters. Many times we have forgotten that. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 through verse 2 says, "Now there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Many will follow in their depravity, and because of them, the way of truth will be defamed." And Jesus Christ says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, Jesus Christ says, "Watch out for false prophets." This is why Christianity, this is why discernment in Christianity is so important. We must learn to discern. We must learn to examine these prophecies. We must learn to examine the ministry of the word to ensure that what is being said, that what is being taught is of the word of God and not just the pastor's opinion, not just the leader's opinion. We're not here to glorify the pastor. We're not here to glorify our church leaders. We're not here to glorify our denomination. We're here to glorify God. And so we must ensure through the examination of what is being proclaimed to us, we must ensure that we are glorifying God, that everything that is being said is of God, that the things that we're being taught is of God. Another thing that we see in the Word of God is this, because we hear so many people nowadays. We hear so many people nowadays, even especially in the extreme charismatic movements. We hear all these prophets making all these prophecies, and none of them ever comes true. And yet we still continue to believe in these things. But Deuteronomy chapter 18 verse 22 teaches us about this already. He said in Deuteronomy chapter 18 verse 22, it says that if what a prophet proclaims in the name of the Lord does not take place or come true, this is not a message of the Lord. So if there's someone out there that's proclaiming to you that, man, this is going to happen or that's going to happen, and they're proclaiming that they are a prophet of God, but all the things that they say to you never come true, what the word of God is saying is that this is not a true prophet of God. This is not someone that is speaking for God. This is a false prophet. Discernment is very important. When we fail to discern, we quench the Holy Spirit. When we fail to discern, we are not looking at the prophecies or the ministry of the word as something that is essential to our lives. And the third point goes on to talk about holding on to what's good and rejecting all that is evil. The word of God teaches us that the natural man cannot receive the things of the Spirit. Without the Spirit of God, we cannot understand. We cannot even begin to understand these things. And so we must walk in the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says that we must walk in the Spirit so that we can know the things of the Spirit. We must walk in the Spirit so that we don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. A person who walks in the flesh will try to live for the flesh, will try to fulfill the things of the flesh. But the one who walks in the Spirit, who has the Holy Spirit within him or her, their desire will be the desires of the Holy Spirit. And this is how we discern. This is how we know what is good and how we know what is evil. The desires of our hearts will be changed. The man, the carnal man who continues to walk in the flesh, will continue to desire the lust of the flesh, will continue to seek to fulfill the lust of the flesh. they will have no understanding of the things of the Spirit. But the one who walks in the Spirit, his heart has been changed. He has experienced the supernatural new birth. He has been regenerated. The desires of his life has been changed. The desires of his life are the desires of the Spirit, or the desires of God. And he can test his own desires by simply reading the Word of God, you see. You may be sitting there, you may be saying, well, how can I tell the difference between the desire of the flesh? How can I tell the difference if I am walking in the flesh or if I am walking in the Spirit? Because nowadays, many times what we see is Christians all over the world, whatever they feel, whatever they want to do, they claim that it is of the Spirit. But the Word of God is not saying that to us. The way we know is whether or not our desires are desires of the flesh, or if they are the desire of the Spirit, is simply by reading the Word of God, by examining our desires, our passions, through the study of the Word of God. And so if you have this passion in you, you have this desire in you that you feel so strongly for, you feel so strongly about, but when you read the Scripture and the Scripture is contradicting what you're feeling, then you must submit yourself to the Scripture. You must submit yourself to what God has revealed to you. Because what you are feeling is not of the Holy Spirit. What you're feeling is of the flesh. And when we walk in the flesh, we quench the Spirit. When we walk in the flesh, we don't allow the Spirit to minister unto us. And so we must hold on to what is good. What is good is of the Spirit. We must hold on to it. We must get a firm grip on it. That's what hold on means. That you must grip onto it. You must hold firm unto it. And you must reject all that is evil. In other words, reject the things of the flesh. Reject it all. You must avoid it. Here in Marysville, we have Ellis Lake. We have this lake, Ellis Lake here. Probably, you know, inside in the middle of our city here. And many of you driving from Oroville through Marysville, you would have driven by Ellis Lake. Some of you, I imagine some of you have taken the time to walk around Ellis Lake. But you know, one of the things about Ellis Lake is that they don't clean it up. They don't clean Ellis Lake. And so Ellis Lake is filled with all these duck poop all over the park. So it makes it kind of difficult to take your children there to walk around because they don't clean it up. It's filled with all these duck poop all over the park, all over the lake. And so many times when I would go over there with my kids, with my children, I would go over there, I would watch my step carefully because I don't want to step on any of that. I would try to navigate myself around that to avoid that as much as possible. When my kids were little, when my kids were still, you know, young, I would carry them, not allowing them to step on any of that. We would try to avoid it as much as possible. And when the Word of God says that reject all evil, that's what it's talking about. You're just talking about avoiding it as much as possible. Just like when I was walking on Ellis Lake and I'm trying to, you know, maneuver myself around all that so that I won't step on it. The same thing applies when we're to avoid it. And so the message today for us is for us to remember that as we prepare ourselves this Christmas season or this Advent season for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, that we must not quench the Spirit. We must not quench the Spirit. We must not treat prophecies with contempt, but we must test them all. And the third thing for us to remember as we prepare ourselves is that we must hold on to what is good, reject every kind of evil. Let us pray together. Lord, thank you so much for your message today. This is a time, a season in which we do prepare our hearts, and we are reminded of the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ. Not only in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago, but we are reminded of his coming in the future, his second coming, to judge the world. We pray that you prepare our hearts for that time. We pray that we'll be able to live our lives to glorify you as we wait for that day. Be with us, Lord. Protect us, Lord. Keep us in the faith. We lift everyone up to you on this day in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Okay, thank you so much for being with us today for our worship service. And once again, just want to remind all of us, my hope is that I want to get videos from every family in our church. I know that may not be possible, but that is the goal, and that's what I want to be able to do, is receive a video from every family, and so that way we can I can post them up, or I can display them on Christmas Eve for a Christmas Eve service at 6 p.m. So I do encourage you to do that. If you have any issues with that, please do let me know. I'll see if there's some way that I can help you put that together. With this pandemic that's going on, it's so difficult for us to for me to be able to come and help you. I mean, what I want to do is I want to come to your house and help you out, put these things together, but because of the pandemic, it's just difficult for us to do. But I'm hoping that I can maybe help you with the phone or something like that, to put these things together if you're having issues with these things. And so I do hope to get a video from every family. And if you don't want to sing, you don't have to sing, just say Merry Christmas, New Year, or something like that, Happy New Year, or something like that, just a short message to the church, just let everybody know you miss the church and miss everybody, or something like that, whatever you want to say. And so I do encourage you to send these videos to me as soon as possible. I'll start working on them this week already, so just let all of us know. And once again, thank you so much for joining us. I know it's a rainy day out there, but everybody stay safe and stay dry, and we'll meet again next week. Until then, God bless everyone and keep you safe and protect you. God bless.